Gordon there. He had.
I wouldn't go that far.
Oh, he's got always grown.
I've got my little toys here, so just something to kind of look at. When I do the presentation, I can just, you know.
He is also royalty up there in North Bend. His wife is the mayor of North Bend. And he can't fly drones up there because there's an airport up there, and all these drones are smart enough that they won't take off in controlled airspace, which is, so he came down here to see our program and to see how it's doing, and he's got a little presentation for us. So if we can give him a
especially with the FPV. I don't know if any of you guys are familiar with FPV drones. That's the fun part of the drones. But what I'll do is just do a quick of drones in general, because there's a lot to it. So what I'll do is I'll just talk about just introductions, daily life, commercial, some of the stuff. And I'm actually looking into more of a commercial level, like, you know, doing photogrammetry and LiDAR, and sure, also too, the public safety side of things. And then they'll go into like the future of drones, and you know, we're gonna see it with like delivery services, and also even, you know. Drones are technically an aerial device that you control from the ground, basically, in a nutshell. And then, going through the years, you know, they even had a plane back in 1941 that was basically a drone. And then they go into the 40s, and then you get the modern. Services, I'm sure you guys have heard about those, or where they can go with that. Agriculture, and that's actually a cool thing. I'm from California, in the Central Valley, where they have a ton of ag. And I know a lot of friends that have the tractors and do the dispersement of chemicals or whatever, they're starting to use drones a lot more because they're much easier just to get the chemical out there. And drones are going to be called upon. A lot of the government will say, hey, does anyone have a drone? We need to take some footage of these areas just in case there's something going on. They can get an idea of what's happening. So what I want to go talk about is obviously industrial applications, some of the things that are happening. I've been trying to talk to a lot of people in the industry that does a lot of commercial building or just have plants. Let's say like you've got some of the mills here and stuff like that. They need inspection on some of the towers or some of the equipment. Instead of having someone go up on the equipment, they can just fly drone in here, take a whole bunch of pictures, and then that way they can go back and look at it. One of the first things I'll start here with is agriculture soil monitoring. These drones will have like sensors on them, which they can pick up like the heat. They have, you know, they can see where it's hot and cold within the field. I've seen a video where they have this drone that would loiter and go up and down, and you would see these spots where they say, okay, you know, field could potentially die here, we can do something about it, whether it's, you know, soil monitoring or something like that. So there's a real big need for that, especially in agriculture. A cool thing I saw was like livestock movement. Surveillance cameras, basically. And so they can just have it sit there and loiter and just keep an eye on things as things are happening. And if they need to move them, they can move them and all that kind of stuff. Documentation of accidents. I know sometimes they use those for accidents because you see the skid marks and all this kind of stuff. And if they can fly above and get pictures of the accident scene, that helps them with investigation later on. And then, too, surveying the situation before sending the team. I've seen they're looking at doing drones similar to like this, where it's got the little prop guard. They can fly these inside a house, and they can fly around and make sure there's, you know, no one in there with a gun or what, just to help protect the police. So that's something that they're looking at.
Cell phone or radio or something like that, they could pick up, you know, the signals.
Like I said, noise, the visual disturbance, all that kind of stuff. There's those issues too. So you don't want to be flying over a crowd of people. It's like I've seen it in like videos of people flying drones right over people's heads at the beach or whatnot, and it's not fun feeling. So current regulations, laws governing drone usage. So FAA is obviously the big one that's kind of overseeing drones, because technically the FAA owns the airspace. Well, not actually, they really don't own the airspace. It's actually, I don't know if you know the word easement, it's sort of an easement. Theoretically, everybody, where the property is, they own the space up to infinity. But unfortunately, the legal case. Theoretically, any aircraft that flies in that space is part of the FAA, you know, realm. So any of the aircraft is technically an easement. And so you're up there. And especially it's an aircraft. If someone tries to shoot down your drone or something like that, they could, and if you have all the evidence, they could be sent to federal jail for, I don't know how long, a year or two or something like that. I've had people say, I'm gonna shoot that down. I said, go right ahead. I got my camera out. I'm recording this, shoot it down. You can go to federal jail if you shoot it down, because technically it's an aircraft, like a plane. And a plane can fall on someone and hurt them, if not kill them. So that's one of the things why FAA is really stringent on drones right now, because there's a lot more of those flying around. They can either, you know, fall on someone, hurt someone, hit a car, the car loses control, you know. So that's some of the things with that why FAA is really strong with their regulations. Some of the other things, like this drone right here, which I know you guys probably, do you guys have the Mini 2s or 3s?
Yes, we've got Mini 2s and Mini 4s.
So this is considered a sub 250 drone. It's, to some degree, I mean, it still hurt if it hit someone or hit another plane or something like that. But there's... And I've done that before. Yeah. Trust me, it's not fun. Better than that one. But still, they consider these sub 250s because there should theoretically be less damage and issues with a smaller, lighter drone. More, I always tell someone, like, hey, I want to get a drone. And I said, go get the Mini 3 or 4. Now the 4s have the 360 sensors. And these are great. You could almost, if you were to go out of the country, like say to Mexico or something like that, you could take it down with no issues. I've seen a lot of reports where people take the bigger drones and then they confiscate it there at the airport because it's a bigger drone. It's got more issues and stuff like that. So this is definitely a good thing to go for if you get a drone.
Let me make a comment. When he's saying 250, that's in grams, and anything less than 250, you don't have to register with the FAA, but anything above 250, you do have to register. So we've got two Mavic Pros, big ones like he has, and they're both drones, but you have to follow FAA guidelines and be certified to fly those.
Remote ID. So there's little sensors in these, specifically these two drones, as these don't have it yet. But these two drones have a sensor in it where they can see where the drone is. They know that it has a little asset tag or serial number on the top. This is like your license plate on your car. So, but this also transmits that signal from here. So they know who belongs to that drone. That's also if you lose it and then they look at it, well, we can look it up and find out who the owner is. But the ID that's being transmitted, they can see where that drone is. In fact, there's one time when I was flying right outside of North Bend, just right where the Toyota dealership is, right out of that zone where you can go up a certain height.
And the city manager, our friend, called because he's a drummer. And I guess he has a friend that works in the industry that's doing the ID stuff. And he calls me and he goes, "Hey, are you flying your drone?" And I said, "Yeah, how'd you know?" And he goes, "Oh, we could see it in the system that they had set up." They don't have it anymore, but still, it's predominantly law enforcement and certain other police people. I've even called the tower once and I said, "Do you have the drone ID thing?" They said, "They don't have it yet, but they'll get it soon." I've been downloading the apps to see if I can see the drones and see what's going on and all that kind of stuff. Apparently, we don't have any sensors just yet, but they will get those up at some point, especially law enforcement's looking at it. Because in case a drone ends up hitting, you know, someone's house or a car or something like that, at least they can track down the drone or less. I mean, a lot of this stuff is just for safety reasons. So that way no one does anything mischievous, especially if you're buying one of these drones and spying on the neighbors or looking in windows or something like that, they can pull it up and say, "Hey, you shouldn't be really doing that." Whether you're registered or not, they still can pick it up. So some of the things, obviously AI is the big thing these days, artificial intelligence. A lot of these drones, in fact, some of these commercial drones that they have, like the DJI Matisse, 30 of the 350s, they're starting to integrate AI in there, where if you're flying from point A to point B, it'll determine, issues and go around it. I mean, it's not like AI, like ChatGPT level or anything like that, but still, it knows not to, it needs to get from point A to point B, hopefully weather, it'll avoid a whole bunch of different things. Also, the safety measures is one of the things, because it is up in the air with people that are theoretically sitting in a chair in a plane. You want these things to avoid other people if you need. So 5G cellular, some of these industrial commercial drones, they're putting in a cell, chip in there. So see the drone in the ID, they can shut that thing down. So they could transfer, rather than a helicopter, which takes up fuel and a lot of manpower, this would be a lot cheaper to have these things go up and down the coast, weather permitted, and it'll just land and just, you know, the ground, you know, plug it in, charge it up, and then for the next person who sees it, they can use that. And it's all unmanned, just controlled from a remote location. This Joby, actually, I saw in person. A buddy of mine has a private plane, and he picked me and my wife up in just right outside of SFO, and he's down in Monterey, actually Carmel Valley. And so we landed, and he goes, "Oh, there's the Joby." And I was like, "Oh, really?" And so it was really kind of cool. So I ended up kind of sneaking into the hangar and got in trouble. I don't promote that, but not really sneaking in. It was the whole hangar door was open. And I walked in, like, "You're not supposed to be in here." I'm like, "Okay, sorry." But I did get something in front of it. So, but still, it was really kind of cool to see that. And that's actually, that Joby was like one of the premier ones that really pushed them. Like, they're flying that thing every day, testing the heck out of it. You know, rain or shine, they're out there flying it all the time, which is kind of cool. But I bet you in your lifetime, you'll start to see a lot more of these things.
I bet so too. Is that J-O-V-E, Jovi, or J-O-V-E?
J-O-V-E. J-O-V-E, yeah. I think that's how it's spelled. Jovi. Like I said, drone hubs and recharging stations. It's like, you know, the Teslas and stuff like that. You'll probably see a lot more of these at the FBOs or airports or something like that. FBOs meaning, I guess, forward base of operations, which is what the airport has, with all the private jets. And so you'll see a lot more of those. So storm intelligence, that's pretty old, and they're trying to get that updated as much as they can, so that way there can be a lot. And that's one of the things with the increased regulatory and the laws and everything like that. They're hoping to get more of those up in the air, because I know a lot of like friends, they all have these now iPads or these, you know, displays that show where every single aircraft is in the area. So that way, that's one of the things why they want those IDs on the drones. So that way they can see where all these objects are up in that space, just for safety reasons. Let's see here. Prediction of the drones, how they shape the various aspects of daily life. Healthcare. So this is actually the zip drone. There's a video out there. This guy, I don't know if you've ever seen those videos, the guy that did the Amazon box that did the glitter and the smell, like whenever
someone's. Mark Rover?
What's that?
Mark Rover?
Yes, that guy.
He worked that fast.
What's that?
He worked that fast.
Okay, yeah. And so he did a video on this, and if you ever Google it, go out to YouTube, look it up, they'll show where they use this down in Africa to deliver like plasma and supplies to hospitals that were very remote. And he was like sitting there, and they launched it, and they said it was there like within like 30, 40 minutes. And they would come back, and then they would catch up with this big giant net. But then he would drive out there, and it took him like 4 hours, you know, through these dirt roads and mountains and stuff like that. And he goes, "This is the quickest way to get supplies to this hospital, especially someone who's, you know, injured. There's not enough blood or whatever. They can get it out to them quicker." So this is one of the things that they're they're working with them. Of course, they're doing the whole urban, you know, drone delivery service as well. But this is definitely something kind of cool that they're doing. This is the new DJI Flycart 30. I'm kind of trying to talk, you know, the individuals within the county to look at purchasing some of these, but unfortunately, these things are like $40,000 a pop. But these can carry up to 50 pounds. And I'm telling them, like, in case we ever get in a disaster or something like that, we could use these to deliver, you know, supplies to various parts of the county, remote places, like, let's say, Allegheny or something up there, where the Mahaffey Ranch, you know, Pumpkin Patch, there's that old school there. They deliver stuff there, like plasma and medicine that people need their medicine on a regular basis, but if they have a situation where they can't get across the bridges or they can't get, you know, over there, this could just deliver supplies on a regular basis. And so that's something I was trying to talk to, you know, them investing or get grant money to buy some of these and have a team of people that are kind of, you know, learn or training to fly these. And I have a friend of mine that does disaster preparedness, and he was like, oh, we're looking at these Dutch ones and stuff like that. But can people just pick up the controller and how to fly it? Where these have the same kind of controller or the same setup as like the DJI. So anyone can pick up the controller and fly these things if need be. Like I said, delivery, emergency supplies. And that's this last mile of delivery is that whole thing I was telling you about with the zip drone, where they can just deliver packages the last mile. Like I said, the monitoring treatment of crops leading to increased agricultural efficiency. That's definitely something I know that that's a big trend going on in the South. You know, a lot of people, that's industry that's really well. One of the cool things about the environment monitoring and changes, so they can look at a lot of the areas where, like the city, we've got all the rivers here and how they're changing and all that kind of stuff. They could even have it where the drones can just go up and, you know, they have that set waypoints and stuff like that, and they can monitor things as time goes on. And they can look at a trend as the year goes by, a couple years go by, and at least they can see if things are changing or not. And that, or safety is actually another big thing. I just, you know, with the second Dune movie that's coming out, I guess the Sand Dunes here was kind of inspired by the author of the book, Dune. And the reason why it was out there back in 1962 or something like that, he was doing a project writing articles on the Department of Agriculture and how the dunes were shifting and how we're losing the dunes. So that's where some of these drones are coming into play. They monitor and see where the dunes are going as time goes on. One of the other things, especially with some of the blades that they're starting to come out with, have you ever seen those little figure eight looking blades? They're supposed to be low noise, but still have the efficiency as the regular blades. And I know, like, I've seen some documentarians down in Africa who do a lot of, you know, pictures and videos of, you know, wildlife with drones. They'll use the pro with the camera that's, you know, the zoom, was it 25 times zoom or 20 zoom or something like that. They can be far away from birds. Limitations, battery life, you can only from steel for so long, but they're getting better as time goes on. I'm sure as the technology changes, safety and collision is one of the things. Too many drones up there, like me, where I live right between the city limits and North Bend. Actually, I'm on the flight path, and so I can't even launch these drones where I live, you know, or test them or play with them or anything like that. So I basically have to go somewhere else to fly on a regular basis. Traffic management, you know, that's where the ID comes into play, especially weather out here. I've been asked to do some photos for someone, you know, to take pictures of their property, and I can't get up because of, well, A, it's right next to the airport, and B, the weather's just been problematic. And then the integration of airspace, and then public acceptance is still, that's just one of those things. And then, I'm going to get to the fun part. Go ahead, Adam. Questions, discussion, answers, all that kind of stuff. Does anyone have any questions or anything?
I got a question for you. So you have your FAA certification.
Yes. Yes.
Where did you get that? And how much did it cost?
Well, that, I got it right here. I got that. Well, I found, and it's funny because, like, when I was kind of getting into this, and of course, all my research, so kind of my research is YouTube, because it's just convenient, and it's on my TV at home, and some of that, I'll just go through all my, you know, channels, and I'll look through it, and obviously there's one site, I can't remember the name of the site, but there's a site where I did it online, and I spent a good 6 months studying for it, so this is my little license that I have to fly my drone, and I'll pass around if you guys want to look at it.
So you found the site online to do your FAA.
Yes.
Because we've got our recreational permits.
Yes.
And that's online. That's real easy.
Yeah.
But I heard the FAA was a challenge past that.
It is, but it's kind of nice to have. I mean, if you go out to the drone zone at all, it's the FAA's website for that.